morning or good afternoon. My name is Peter Minnium, a consulting director at the IAB in New York. I have the pleasure of moderating the CEO Media Talk session. Note that the three people who I'm going to introduce now control probably over half of the media dollars in the ecosystem. So pay close attention, and if you want, drop business cards on their chairs after they leave. And the theme is simple. The business of media inventory management is under tremendous pressure. Prices are being driven down relentlessly, while complexity increases at an unyielding pace. Media agencies, it seems, are bearing the brunt of the cost of the digital revolution. And yet, for those who survive, the experience gained from being on the front lines can become a long-term competitive advantage. Here to help us understand what it will take to not only survive, but thrive in the digital future, are three of the media agencies' best and brightest, and I'd like to invite the three of them up on stage at the same time, Maria Luisa Francoli, Steve King, and Matt Seiler. By way of introduction, Maria Luisa Francoli, no wonder what these things are here for, thank you, is a truly revolutionizing figure in the advertising industry, currently the global CEO of MPG and Havas Media North America. Maria Luisa has served many roles at MPG since first joining in 1993. In 1997, Maria Luisa combined her extensive background with her instincts about the future of the industry to create Media Contacts, a digital agency within Havas Media, which is now a leading global interactive media network. In 2003, Maria Luisa was appointed CEO of Media Planning, and in 2006, CEO of MPG. Under her leadership, MPG North America has set a creative and effective precedent, collecting several firsts, including a coveted Cannes Media Lion. Steve King, CEO worldwide of Zenith Optimedia, began his career in 1982, working in media selling. He then moved to Ted Bates, McCormick's, and finally BSB Dorland before being selected as one of the founding directors of Zenith in 1998. In 1993, Steve oversaw the creation of Zenith Media USA and took over as CEO of that business in 1995 before moving to CEO Zenith Media EMEA. In 2000, Zenith became part of Publicis, and Steve was part of the management team that oversaw the successful merger with the Optimedia Network. In 2004, Steve was promoted to his current position of CEO of Zenith Optimedia Worldwide. He has served on the P12, the management executive team of Publicis Group, since 2004, and was one of the architects of Vivekey. And finally, Matt Seiler is global CEO of Mediabrands. From being an account guy to a strategic planner, Matt has been in all sides of the marketing and media world. Matt was named CEO of Mediabrands, a dynamic media and marketing group containing UM Initiative and Mediabrand Ventures in January of 2011. Matt was previously global CEO of UM, which he transformed, redefining the scope of media services to encompass all forms of marketing communications and bridge the gap between media and creative agencies. Wow, that is an impressive group, and I should have cut those down by half.
Yes.
Now,
you wonder why they're sleepy.
It's a very good question. So now, before we start, I need your help on one thing, and that is, can you put up the slide, please? The Judy slide, please. So I need your help with my daughter, Judy. You see, Judy's very upset because today is my birthday, and Judy is wondering who's going to say happy birthday to me. So can everybody here do me a favor, on the count of three, say happy birthday, Peter. So, ready? One, two, three.
Happy birthday, Peter.
Thank you very much. That solves that issue. Now let's get into the discussion. And thank you. Thank you very much. I will be accepting my birthday drink starting at 1:30 outside here. So let's start with the first question. I'm going to get a little bit more comfortable by discussing how you guys are going to survive this vicious circle. As I mentioned in what has now been very clearly labeled as the longest and most inappropriate introduction of the day, thank you, Matt.
You're welcome.
The business of media inventory management is under tremendous pressure. I believe that media agencies are bearing the brunt of the cost of the digital evolution. Creative agencies, by contrast, have stayed mostly siloed, but this is not an option for you guys. You're expected to have a continually broader capability as new platforms come on stream, and many of these require real investments in talent and technology. Yet we know the budgets are limited, and clients simply don't want to pay extra for the intelligence. If you survive the digital evolution, I think you'll be uniquely qualified to reap the benefits in an all-digital world. But will you? What's the secret to surviving this vicious circle today? And Matt, since you put me on the spot, I'm going to lead right off with you.
Fair enough. If we survive, that's a bold stance in a really long question, too. Everything is sort of long. The question's long.
Thank you.
With boldness. So I think that the way that we get paid right now is dumb, and we have risk of not surviving if we have to have our clients line up with exactly how our talent is paid, and if everything is based on commissions or fees based on numbers of human beings working on business. And the way that we will survive, the way that we will prosper, the way that we will conquer is to actually line up with our clients' business outcome. So it's not about the digital staff and how hard it is to get them and what do they cost, but rather how much can we actually track what we're doing as showing up for their bottom line. And it's something that we have talked about as an industry for 30 years. People like we have sat on stages complaining about what procurement is doing to us, and it's terribly unfair and we've been marginalized, which is just not right. We have to get the very best talent and line up the talent with business outcome, and then we're all good.
So I'm going to move right from that into a question which is around how you get the very best talent and how you use that talent. For me, it's another gap. It's another issue. And from my vantage point at the IAB, I call it sort of the information knowledge paradox because I have the notes, I can use the term paradox, hopefully without ridicule, Matt. But that is that, to me, media agencies have tremendous experience in digital media, gained daily by executing plans in every conceivable new media, while publishers have similar experience from creating content, packaging, and selling it. Yet every publisher I know complains about the shallow knowledge of what they call two junior buyers, and every media exec I talk to tells me how starved they are from strategic insight from publications. And similarly, a lot of marketers talk about how quickly high-level strategic conversations turn to low-level tactical ones. Information is, of course, valuable, but as an industry, we seem obsessed with the what and spend too little time and energy on the why, which is how data turns to knowledge. The holy grail for marketers is strategic intelligence driven by data. How do you guys provide that within a tenable cost structure? Luisa, you care to take that one?
Yes. I think sharing is the key, and I don't think we do a good enough job, neither agencies nor publishers, in sharing the information that is valuable to build on that and to be better in the future. I think agencies, we have our platforms, we have a lot of technology, and we know exactly how one publisher performs about against the other, but yet we don't share that with the publishers so that they can improve and they can do better. The same way that publishers don't share what works with different advertisers, different techniques, and that doesn't help us and the clients go. So it's about sharing, and if we share a little bit more, and technology today allows us to share data at a very granular, detailed level, we could do better, and we would not be complaining about it's not enough seniority at the other side of the table because we don't put the tools and the information that allows us to have this more senior relationship or conversation. So I think we're both sides of the table are a little bit guilty of what is going on.
Steve, how about at Zenith Optimedia? I have to say that none of the publishers have told me about your terribly junior and shallow buyers, but I guess I haven't looked around enough. they're in the coalface, really, every day gaining this experience, mm-hmm. and yet it seems to be lost every night at 7 o'clock when some publisher is paying for their their drinks. As an organization, is there an opportunity? Is there a way to turn this serially gained information day to day into real competitive advantage for your clients?
I think I'm going to go back to your original question and sort of link the two together, because when you're talking about this sort of vicious circle and can we survive, I think certainly on behalf of our media agency and the organization, I'm sure that on behalf of the other two, you know, we're in a period of expansion and growth, and the opportunities that we've got at the moment are far greater than they were 10 years ago. We're expanding the scope of work, and definitely digital and the different avenues it opens up has been a huge boom for us, both in terms of the movement we've been able to make from a transactional partner on behalf of our client to becoming much more of a added value, strategic value-added partner. And that's a real shift that's taken part over the last 10 years. At the same time, we've also had to do flawless execution. But I would say that the people that we're now employing, we're anticipating that they, from day one, are going to have a strategic insight as well as doing the execution. We as an agency have this positioning of the ROI, the return on investment agency. And part of it is really to school our key talents in order that they have a breadth, but they do have to come in and understand, you know, from the tactical knowledge. And I think that's why we're able to grow, because if a client's got the choice about, okay, I've got someone who's got the helicopter view, but is removed from the tactical execution,
yeah.
And so much of the differentiation is understanding how these new platforms, the Googles, Facebooks, et cetera, are interacting, how consumers are using technology in a new way. So I think one of the reasons I feel very optimistic, and currently we're doing very well, I mean, as a sector, is because we have both the tactical as the transactional side, as well as the added value part. So certainly there's a squeeze on our talent. We're bringing in a different sort of caliber of people, and probably the thing that has grown most exponentially for us has been our investment in training in order to address some of the areas you're talking about. They do exist,
yeah.
But you know, I think we're in a good place to move upstream, both with our talent and with our clients. And I think the publishers will benefit from that.
So I think you're very kind, each of you, not to turn the question 180 degrees and talk about what publishers need to do, which is quite a similar exercise, really, moving from tactical sales, which is still 98% of the conversations, mm-hmm. to a really strategic sale.
Well, it's when you have the conversation, to Maria Luisa's point. If the transaction or the conversation is only around transaction, if it's salespeople dealing with buyers at the end of the process, you're not going to get a very good result. The people on our side are going to feel as though they're being sold something, so they're trying to figure out what it is you're trying to slip by.
Yeah.
And the publishers aren't allowed to engage strategically. Where if you get involved in the very beginning and you say, here's what we're looking to do, here's something that we know about the audience that you could help us with because you have tremendous data, and here's what we're trying to do, again, back to that business outcome. So if you actually engage with them like they're human beings, much like account people, strategy people, and creative departments, give them 2 weeks, give them a month to come up with ideas, that's how you get really good content. Then it's not about the transaction in the end, but you have to change your whole structure in order to be able to do that. So we created experience architects that are about creating that sort of content journey from the beginning. You can't just sort of hope it's going to be different and keep the same people in place for the change of outcome. That's sort of definition of madness.
So building on this notion of the relationship with publishers, I'd like to talk a little bit about the blurring between media owners and media buyers, enabled by the emergence of inventory exchanges and data platforms, among other things. So today, it is quite possible for a media agency, such as these guys, Lead, to buy media from an exchange and resell it at a higher rate with value enhanced by data and insight to clients. From my perspective, and especially talking about the pressures you guys are under from a cost perspective, it seems obvious that media agencies are well-placed and perhaps even deserving contenders to benefit from the value created by remassing audiences from individual impressions. Is this a widely shared view, and is this a new and emerging part of your business?
I agree, and what I don't agree to is that this is new and only in the digital world. I mean, in the past years, we used to try to make agreements in terms of how to add value to some piece of media that we could buy and resell, but changing the format, changing the way that that media was aggregated. And the key to make this a fair thing is to be transparent. I mean, to be transparent with your client and to explain what you are doing, what you are getting, the value that you are adding, and what you're offering to the client. And that, I think, is very fair because we see it, and particularly today, in a world where we have so much information, so much data, that applying this data to build something that could be more tailor-made, more adequate for our clients is definitely a good thing that we can do. But again, you have to be transparent about what you are doing and why you are doing it.
Yeah, so some of our competitors, not represented on the stage necessarily, do a lot of arbitraging, which is not something that we believe in, and we just actually launched Cadreon today here in Germany. So we are very much about the exchange, but absolutely about the transparency. It's about, again, that real understanding of who the audience is and finding them where they're most engaged. So it's not about, you know, forming an investment bank on our behalf, but rather getting the audiences in the most efficient way for our clients, each individual client, not for a fund that we manage.
I think you said in your introduction, Peter, I think you said that 50% of all global spend is represented through our groups. I think you should have had some of the other 50% because I know that all three of our groups are absolutely very clear that we are not into arbitrage, which is buying at one price and then selling it to another, and then somehow there's some sort of secret markup. You know, we're creating technology platforms that help our clients. You know, we're trying to amass audiences and then connect them with consumers. You know, we've created our own platform called AOD, which is a technology layer which helps connect with consumers. But I think that emphasis on transparency and working with our clients and trying to drive value, and whether that be through our own platform called AOD or through the ad exchanges, but we are, I know all three of our groups are not getting into arbitrage, and we've been very clear that's something that we're not doing.
Absolutely.
That's fantastic. So if I
very
was in the
answer, though, you could really do with someone arguing in favor, but
well, no, it's, if I really wanted some good tweet bait, I would name the people who are doing the arbitraging. But
well, it's not hard to figure out, given that they're not represented on the stage. There's only a couple missing.
Thanks very much. And so, so I want to talk about the blurring as well, continued blurring of the business between content buyers, such as yourself, and content creators, that is, between publishers and media agencies. So in the US, Meredith, big publisher, has Meredith Integrated Marketing. It's an agency. It's definitely an agency providing marketing services beyond the titles that they represent. And it's just one example of publishers doing this. To me, there seems to be a huge opportunity for media agencies to repay the favor. After all, if you guys get a couple of percentage points to buy space alongside publisher content, and the publisher is creating a media services group to try and take those few percentage points away from you. Why not repay the favor and create content yourself and take 100% of the pie? Are you guys taking advantage of this blurring? Are you specifically creating content for your clients or helping them amass audiences around their own content, bypassing all those greedy publishers 100%? I don't know. What do you want to start with that, Maria
Luisa? It's not a matter of bypassing. I mean, everybody is creating content. Every single consumer in the world is creating content, so why not agencies creating content? I mean, we're just one more. And if our content creation or content curation or content finding that we can aggregate from different consumers is the right thing for our clients, definitely. It's not just about the publishing houses. It's about all these consumers or our own that can provide some kind of content that would be better platform to communicate with the audiences of our clients.
Again, we work with the media owners as partners, not threatened by Meredith or anybody else. Good ideas are going to get to clients and get executed if they are good ideas. We did over 1,000 pieces of individually created content on behalf of our clients. So it's more and more of the business that we're in. So it's less about the transmission and the platform in which you work, but rather how good are the ideas, where do they come from? They can absolutely come from crowdsourcing, they can come from creative agency partners, they can come from media owners, they can come from our own teams. So I think that's one of the beautiful things about being alive today, is that ideas come from anywhere and can see the light of day.
So following on that, it's inconceivable to me that given the incredible blurring between creative and media, that media agencies and creative agencies persist in such a separate form. And so, Steve, I'm going to ask you specifically because you started it all. So I'm blaming you for the separation. Maria Luisa, I'm going to come to you in a second because you were also in the early days of separating creative and media. Today, the consumer's perception of creative and media are that they are together. What's an app? Is an app media or is an app creative? For the consumer, they've come back together. Why aren't you guys coming back together?
So this allows me to correct the chronology that you gave of my own history, actually, because I don't know, probably everybody, nobody noticed that. You actually said that the company started in 1998, and then in 1993, I moved to the US. So I thought that was actually, so Zenith started in 1988, and it was started as Zenith Media Buying Services, and that's all we did. We did media buying. And since then, the business has grown exponentially from whatever it was, 150 people, to about 5,500. And one of the great things that's happening at the moment is this blurring. It's happening in our world, and it's absolutely happening on the publisher side. The publishers who we used to deal with used to be content developers and content distributors. You'd have a magazine, they develop content, and they would then publish that. You'd have a TV station that would produce their own programming and then distribute that. Everybody here knows how that blurring has happened. Everybody is in, they might have specialist areas, and the people who are in that field have changed. It's no longer just the traditional media companies. We've got the portals, maybe the digital companies, we've got telcos, et cetera. So this whole blurring is going on everywhere, and it's certainly happening in our world.
So you've admitted that you started it in
1988.
Now we've got that,
right? And certainly we were at the start of what was then a very specialist service, very specialist on media buying. What's happened is that sort of core tenet of providing flawless media buying and execution for clients still obviously is a core principle. But that's allowed us on that relationship to extend that into different areas. And to your specific point, it's absolutely blurring because we're now adding ideas and we're trying to come up with effective ideas that are a combination of both media, creative thinking, and technology all wrapped up together. And interesting, as we're obviously sitting in Germany, we had a unit here in Germany called Newcast, which was our sort of content idea that our entrepreneurial local CEO started without any approval from me, I should tell you. And
and
we saw how that went, and that's something that we have now copied and we've rolled out to about 20 other markets. And that's a content development business that is developing mobile apps, experiential, working in all cases with the publishers, developing great ideas. Very unusual for them to come up an idea on their own, but value ideas brought to life that are connected with reaching the consumer in the most effective way, and to the point Matt paid, absolutely we're getting paid for that.
And so the participating in the blurring of the lines in what is a mile-wide category, totally get it, understand it. I see a great deal of frustration from clients in two areas. One of them is simply understanding the scope of content opportunities available to them. But secondly, and more fundamentally, is the strategic advice to tell them what to do when, where, and why. And so certainly the time has come that we as an industry take an integrated planning approach, that is with traditional brand planning and channel planning, whatever communications planning, whatever you want to call it, at the start of the process together and as an anchor throughout the process so that there is a single roadmap, if you will, a single blueprint for how a client needs to use a set of the content available to them along a journey in a very specific way. Yet I can really count on one hand the number of clients that I talk to, at least in the US, who say, oh yeah, we've got this. I'm not worried about that sea of content and evolution because I have a strategic handle on what happens.
Consider where we are. You walk through the exhibit hall, your head explodes. There's so much stuff in there, and some of it is going to be amazing and revolutionize the world, and some of it's going to be gone in 6 months. And if you're a client, you have no idea where to place your bet because you don't even know what most of that stuff is. Somebody yesterday showed the Lunascope, you know, that chart that has so much glop on it that shows the every single logo of anybody who's in the business in the social space or in the search space or in the mobile space. So what happens is there are a lot of great digital minds that connect with the content creators in the emerging technology space, and the conversation often doesn't go between or go any farther than those two people. So the challenge is how you get those conversations, which are really valuable, into the hands of the media planners, the media buyers, and the clients that they serve. And it's really, really, really tough. We've just launched, as of September 6th, what we call the Virtual Lab, which is a database that has 500 examples of technologies that can be of utility for clients. And it's searchable, it's written in an A to F, so it's dumb simple. It says if you're looking to do A, B is a good way of going because it does C. An example of how it has been used or how we can imagine it being used is D. It costs you about E and takes about F amount of time. So the 6,600 people of Mediabrands can type in mobily connected women, and it pulls up all the things that we have vetted that are good at connecting women mobily. But you have to have those kinds of things, and they have to change absolutely all the time for there to be any great use to it, rather than keeping the conversations with technology people and digital people in the silos in which they live.
So, Matt, I'm from the Interactive Advertising Bureau, as you know, and we're about expanding the entire industry. Certainly, if you made that public to the entire industry and all your competitors, that would be helpful. So, if you want to do...
I'm not really in the business of helping my competitors.
But we're on stage together. We all seem to be getting along so well.
We are getting along really well. No, I think that everybody should find a way to create greater utility for their clients of all things that are possible. And I'm way happy to share what we're doing. But each of us will find our own flavor, and each of us must find our own flavor, much as every agency feels different because of who runs it and because of the kind of talent that they attract and the focus on whether it be digital or content or what have you. So finding a way to take what's in that exhibit hall and turning it into something of value to clients is what each of us has to do. Yeah.
So let me build on that for a second and ask the other two panelists. So I love that idea. It's fantastic. It seems to me that it could be used in the service of expressing an idea, which is one Marcom's model. Let's get an agency to come up with a brand idea, and then let's go to the index and find the most appropriate ways to express that. The other model, though, is starting with the customer and the customer journey, which is not necessarily what idea is most appropriate, but in this journey, what vehicle, what way to talk to them is most appropriate at the right time, which to me is a strategic planning, high-level strategic planning conversation. Stephen, Maria, Luisa, do you find yourself in more or less of those conversations with your clients, or are you chasing ideas with tactics?
No, I mean, sometimes we do, because that happens to all of us. But today is not about one big idea. I think it's about thousands of ideas every day to different points of the purchase channel, at different opportunities to get to the consumer. So the big idea and then make the idea grow and amplify the idea, I think that's a little bit old. I think you need to find the right idea, the right creativity, all the information that you have on where to get your consumer, at what time, in what atmosphere, and how did work before and what is not working. I think it's about thousands of ideas and that come through what is the right point of touch and the right point of connection.
So this brings up a related and important issue, which is we've got the overall communications plan. It's fantastic. We've got a really interesting index and way to understand how the tactics can meet the needs of the various touch points. There seems to me to be a new role opening up in the ecosystem, and that is about managing campaigns in real time.
Absolutely.
Using data and intelligence to tune the programs in an iterative fashion. Now, for performance media, this is easy. It's a machine and math-led algorithm if you're trying to convert credit card users. But for the campaigns that have broader goals, the ones that we want, we at the IAB certainly, want clients to use in the digital space, this is a strategic role informed by data and enabled by technology. In a perfect world, the media agencies would get this role and be paid to do it, leveraging, obviously, the information, the analytics you have, and the coalface experience. Is this role emerging? And if it is it an opportunity for you to add value, move upstream, assert more control, or is it just another thing that you guys are asked to do without additional compensation? Steve, would you like to take a crack at that?
The answer is the former. It's the, I think this is, you know, the whole managing campaigns in real time is definitely something that is happening. If you think of, you know, and I'm sure next year we won't be talking about digital as a separate sort of subset. But let's say it accounts for a third of our total clients' investments. And what we're going to see is all of that media is, you differentiated between performance and I guess there's some non-performance media. All media is moving towards performance. And most media is moving towards the ability to manage in real time. So that's giving you two things. It's the ability to connect with consumers and to respond with different messaging. So we've already talked about the blurring. So you can see how that blurring's happening. Because here we are, we're managing the execution, and suddenly we've got the ability to, you know, we haven't got time to go off and make a 60-second TV ad in 6 months' time. We've got the ability, whether it's in keywords or in terms of display advertising, we've got the ability to distribute differing messaging depending upon the consumers to reacting. So absolutely, that dynamic engagement is something is happening. And then across the top, to your third part, is about the, you know, can we provide a strategic layer and a way of looking at this and really adding value? Absolutely. So it's both yes to performance media, yes it's growing, and yes it's an opportunity to provide a different way of engagement. And if you think, most of us, probably in 90% of our careers, have been spent about pushing media out to consumers, yeah, hoping that consumers are going to recall or remember some of this advertising, and then we hope, based on some syndicated data, that they're going to respond to that. So it's not surprisingly, we're rather enthusiastic about this new change, yeah, because suddenly it takes us, and I would say I've started, you know, my first point about executional, about actually really being connected real time, live with consumers. Now, to your point, that is a whole new world, and it's not surprisingly, we are absolutely not flawless in it, but it's, and you mentioned about the clients in your previous question, Peter, you know, the clients are struggling with how they adopt this, because this isn't just something that happens in their in-house marketing department, it's a retooling of their whole of their business. Just think about the purchase cycle of people buying a car. You can imagine how that changed and how it involves in a whole different level of interaction. It's much bigger than just media, and we are certainly operating at a different level, and from that those days when we were just sort of pushing media out there, hoping our consumers would note and recall some of that.
Those days, 1988.
Yeah.
So you asked if it was something that we were being asked to do that we may or may not be compensated for. I already said that pay for performance is sort of where we all need to get. So it's not a question of whether clients will pay you for data collection and analysis, but rather, if you're moving to a pay for performance model, you have to have that data and you have to have the ability to analyze the data in order to be able to line up with business outcome. So we actually hired McKinsey last year to help us figure out how investment banks, how hedge funds get paid, and how they're more aligned with business outcome than are we. And that data collection is why we prioritize markets around the world, in order to ensure that the third party and we can measure what the overall market is doing, what the competitive set is doing, so that we can align what we do with what our clients are actually looking to do.
Yes, because that is funny. I mean, I came to this industry, I was not a pioneer like you were. I came from the banking industry, from investment banking. And when I arrived and I learned how we charged our clients, I couldn't believe it. I thought they were kidding. And it took me a while to understand. And even today sometimes I'm like totally involved in it and not questioning it anymore. But it's funny. When you come from the outside, you really find it very, very strange. You are a strange industry in that regard. Very strange.
It's very funny. So now I understand how you maintain your calm and elegance at all times. This is your retirement career.
Absolutely.
So I want to pick up on, Matt, this notion of measurement. I think measurement is bad. I think it's an enemy of our industry. And I think it's an enemy of specifically your businesses. We all think that measurement is like motherhood. Of course, it's a wonderful thing. But as I look back over the past 16 years of how measurement in a digital space has evolved, it's clear that the greatest advances in measurement are happening at the lower end of the funnel, which is driving commoditization. And commoditization then drives a media broker pay model. So it's easy to understand why less enlightened competitors are doing arbitrage in a commodity model. The value you guys are adding, though, by contrast, is spread across the purchase funnel, I would argue, with a real value occurring at the top. This is an expensive area for you to play in, and one that is measured least well. So you don't get compensated for the higher value work you're doing. You know, again, I know that you'll disagree and say, no, measurement is like motherhood, we're all for it. But, you know, how can we solve this conundrum?
I want to say something because I don't agree with the premise. I think that we can measure and not just the lower funnel. I think that investing in attribution models and in understanding how attribution works to the very high part of the funnel, if you have the right tools to measure the entire funnel, not just the last part, which is what most people do, then you get compensated for the higher part of the funnel as well. So we are working a lot in attribution, and now we have addressability on one side. We can address and we can attribute. So I think we are perfecting the measurement, and the advancement and the benefit for the advertisers is tremendous. It takes a lot of investment, it takes a lot of technology, and it takes a lot of talent and brain power to really understand how everything works. But I think measurement is amazing. If they had told me when I started that we were just buying ads on TV without any kind of concrete understanding of what was going on and just hoping that it would work, and today we could buy a 20 million people buy in 1 minute and know exactly what is going to happen and what happened before, I mean, it's like it's almost like magic. So I think measurement is a blessing.
So tell me again, and Steve, I want to ask you to comment on this in a second. So the work that you're doing, you talked about two sides, addressability, which is understanding audiences one-to-one, yeah? And then
attribution
or accountability,
yes.
Which is the effect, okay? For certain, on the publisher side, driven by the exchanges, there's unbelievable amount of money, essentially, from your old investment bankers, no doubt,
yes.
Going into the addressability, mm-hmm. Because that's sales in a commodity fashion. But only complaints and half-hearted attempts, really, from the publisher side on this accountability question about attribution. Is this, have we now found a bias in my background? Am I behind the curve? Well, I am behind the curve, but in this particular area, are media agencies doing things in accountability that the publishers aren't really understanding and connecting with?
I think you started with the premise, this measurement is bad, and it's like, in the world when you're buying print or TV, it's like saying measurement is bad, but it was a sort of crutch, really, that allowed us to sort of compare year on year and give some basic KPIs. When you're talking about measurement, clearly there's a funnel there, and we've got measurement that measures activity, and there's still a place for sort of reach-based measurement to see sort of broad-based, and then obviously we're now talking about engagement, and we go to see clients, and clients are, oh, this is of some interest, you're talking to me about engagement. But actually, the clients are now saying, and when we have good meetings, it's when we're able to say, here is the business output of the investment they're making. And before, they would not have expected a media agency to be able to talk to them about that. Now, the reason that we're all investing so much back and why this business is, unfortunately, is polarizing into the big groups, we're having to make big dollar gambles and technology investments into ways of better understanding the top, which we're obviously trying to find efficient ways of measuring the activity and working with the publishers in terms of engagement. But we've got now, we are, particularly if you think those businesses, particularly in the e-commerce area and a lot of those who've got a business which has migrated to the web, et cetera, we've got the ability to actually make investment decisions based on activity and seeing the output and the connectivity between what they're spending, how that's spending, and how it's actually affecting consumer behavior. And that's something that we historically would not have been able to have done.
Your question was, of course, entirely wrong, but there was a statement that you had in your question, which was, our competitors are less enlightened. I like that.
Thank you very much. You're about to get yours, Matt. I do want to say, though, that there's a huge gap in knowledge among the publishing community and therefore among the broader community, especially in the US, about current best practice and attribution modeling. So after this, I'm going to follow up with all of you guys, because if we brought a higher level of understanding to agencies across the spectrum and to publishers about how we can do that, how we can measure upper funnel metrics, I think the industry would move forward quite a bit. So Matt, here's your comeuppance.
Yes.
I want to talk about the Death Star versus Luke Skywalker and the Force. And you've just been named the CEO of a Death Star, meaning a group media company. And the question is this, so holding company media groups like Mediabrands now create the aggregate assets to create leverage that you use to cut macro deals with big publishers, and then create data and technology-enabled DSPs that essentially sell inventory. Steve has very successfully wiggled his way out of the target of this question earlier. Certainly WPP has been particularly aggressive in this regard. To what extent does a media planner or a media operating brand that are now under Mediabrands and other groups really control their own destiny? Is their role now pre-architected as part of a broader business model where they've essentially turned into salespeople to fund the big spaceships' profit engines?
So Death Star is a fascinating concept, yeah. So I think that clients have always been looking for somebody to take responsibility for their business, and they really hoped that the holding company would do that. So big client says to holding company, I'd like you to take care of all my needs, please, and holding company says, I'd like to, but then I've got a conflict situation. So I can't really help you in the CPG space, because if I help you, then I can't work with anybody else in the CPG space, and that sort of defeats the whole purpose of there being a holding company. So I think that the Death Star is actually the right altitude in order to be able to help clients with a whole panoply of offer so that we can more credibly take responsibility for our clients' business outcome. If I were working within a silo and all I could do was chef up media plans and execute them, then I can only be paid a portion of what their business outcome is. But if I am involved in the vast majority of their marketing communications, then I can. And that's the beauty of the Death Star level, is that we have all of the clients' money, which means that we have the attention of the media owners and we can partner around business outcome. And to the question of the publisher, we have challenged a lot of the publishers with whom we work to join us in the pay-per-performance model. So it's not just us taking the risk on business outcome. And by the way, it's a significant risk if you do it right. But the publishers and we join together and say, yes, we will together guarantee that you will achieve your business result and beyond, and we'll profit from it if you do, and we will be punished if we don't.
Gracefully sidestepped, you'll live for Star Wars, the sequel.
Yeah.
So the beauty of sitting over here is that I actually can't see the countdown clock, but my personal watch shows that we are now out of time. So Matt, you get the last word. I thank everybody for the birthday wishes, and Judy is going to thank you later, and I certainly thank the panel.